This is the Maverick, KMSU 89.7 FM Mankato, KMSK 91.3 FM Austin, operating on translator K220AQ in Fairmont, K220AR in Albert Lea. We're also available online at KMSU.org, and we're a proud member of Independent Public Radio.
Any opinions expressed during the following program are those of the hosts and not of KMSU, KMSK, its underwriters, Minnesota State University, Mankato, or the public at large. Thank you.
Your alarm clock goes off, and it's way too early to get up. I know you were out late or something and should really hit the snooze, 'cause it's too early in the morning. Boy, would another few minutes of sleep really do it? Just sleep in today. I'm sure you have some sick days left at work. Tell them you've got the plague. It works every time, every time, and I'll cover for you, 'cause I'm that kind of guy. Well, no, I'm not, but I listen to Shuffle Function with Shy Boy Tim and Shelly. Enemies of commercial radio, their show is almost as good as sleep. It's pop music as pornography. Tell them your car broke down. Tell them you're all snowed in. Just get your sleep. Just get your sleep. Tell them your car broke down. Tell them you're all snowed in. Just get your sleep. Or at least listen to Shuffle Function with Shy Boy Tim and Shelly. Two music geeks on the radio. Their show is almost as good as sleep. It's pop music as pornography. Shuffle Function with Shy Boy Tim and Shelly. It's pop music as pornography. Shuffle Function with Shy Boy Tim and Shelly. It's pop music as pornography. Shuffle Function with Shy Boy Tim and Shelly. It's pop music as pornography. Shuffle Function with Shy Boy Tim and Shelly. Pop music as pornography.
All right, we'll start with your question just right off the bat then, Shelley.
What if Lorelai jumps into a hellhole? Would Rory follow?
You know, there were a lot of Buffy references during these new episodes.
Really?
A lot of them.
Mm-hmm. Was Joss Whedon, like, involved in it somehow?
No, but I'm guessing there's probably a mutual admiration society between creators of beloved series or something.
I feel that if Joss Whedon had been involved, there would have been more deaths. Like, a lot more.
Instead of just the one.
And it would have been the city in peril.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, like the Hellmouth.
Stars Hollow would have destroyed.
And yeah. Lorelai and Rory would have to save Stars Hollow. Mm-hmm. God,
so
that would not go well.
So the answer is yes.
That would not go well at
they
all.
They would both jump. Well, Luke would end up saving them.
Probably. I don't know.
I assume.
Maybe. I mean, like, he seems like he would be.
But he wouldn't
reluctant.
Be happy about it.
Yeah, he'd be like, I got stuff to fix today.
Exactly.
A town to save from the hellhole.
Okay, well, that was Carol King and Louise Goffin. With
her daughter.
Yes.
How appropriate is that? To
I know.
The Gilmore Girls say that it's a mom and min daughter. Oh, my
precious.
Stars. Hollow.
Anyway. And
you
know,
you lead, I will follow.
Yes, and this is our number one of Shuffle Function. I am Shy Boy
Tim. He's counting them already.
We have 3 hours to fill with this. I've been waiting all weekend to talk about this show.
My name is Shelley. We're going to be joined by guests. So far, Caitlin is the early riser.
Right.
Hello.
And we, by the way, Mindy, we have gallons of coffee.
Yeah,
here.
Mindy, don't bring coffee. I'm
so
making it.
We're covered.
As we speak. In fact, I'm leaving my coffee pot up here for you with all the coffee.
Oh, sweet.
So you can have coffee 24/7.
Yeah, we got creamer in one of them and then sans creamer in the other.
We've got creamer that I was like, oh, we should throw these away.
Oh, good.
Because they're from the marathon. But no, they don't expire till 1/21.
Oh.
So we have time.
That's not troubling.
No. cream is good forever.
It's exactly.
It's technically non-dairy most of the time. It's,
yeah.
It's fraudulent. There's no actual cream in the creamer. It's still delicious.
Well, just so you guys know, it's 6:08 a.m., 49 degrees. It's balmy out. It's lovely.
It is.
51 and partly cloudy for your forecast today. 100% chance of Gilmore talk.
Gilmore Gab.
Tuesday, 42 and overcast. Wednesday, snow possibility. And then going into next week, looks like temps are in the mid to upper 30s. So
can
there
I,
you go.
Can I do the theme for the show, Gilmore Gab?
Sure.
It goes like this. I just thought of this too. So withhold.
So this is going to be good.
Withhold your praise till I'm done.
I'm glad you workshopped it.
I'm ready.
Ready?
Yeah.
La 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 la. La 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 la. It's almost done. La 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 la. Gilmore Gab.
Oh jeez.
A slight pause at the end.
Well, okay, so on Black Friday, four new episodes of Gilmore Girls appeared. A year in the life.
As if an early Christmas present.
For real.
Waiting outside your Christmas tree even before you had it up.
Yeah, so we're going to be talking about this all morning. If you have any questions or comments or haikus or
opinions,
whatever.
Loved it, hated it.
If you watch the episodes and you want to chime in, you know that when this show was on the air, it was a huge part of the morning show. We would recap it every morning after the show had aired the night before.
Tim would recap it.
It's true, much to the joy and pain of many listeners. It's just been an important show. In general. And so we're going to be talking about Gilmore Girls all morning long, right here on 89.7 The Maverick.
So it's been, we were just talking about this, it was 9 years since the show ended that this picked up.
Yeah. In fact, it's crazy because Rory is the same age in these episodes as Lorelai was when the series started.
That, I think, is the weirdest part.
That's crazy.
Do they mention that then?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I think they don't
say you're the same age as I was 12 years ago. You know, they don't say that.
You're the same age that I was when I was you.
Yeah, exactly. They don't say that, but you know, it's a kind of a weird synchronicity thing.
Yeah, because I think a lot of people noted, like when rewatching the series, that like, oh my God, Lorelai's 32, and a lot of people have been around that age when at least recapping and watching it again.
Yeah.
So then when you hear that Rory is, I think you constantly compare, like, what was Lorelai doing at your age? You screw up. So
yeah, right. Yeah.
And so how did the series itself end? And did they pick up on that? Or because she wasn't involved in that last year.
Amy Sherman Palladino.
Was it kind of
right.
like Community, where they just really didn't acknowledge that whole last year happening?
Like
too
the
much?
Gas year or the gas leak?
The gas leak year, yeah. Right? I'm trying to think because I haven't rewatched season 7 since it aired. I hated it so much. What do you feel about season 7?
Oh, no. Season 7 was kind of a disaster.
Yeah.
Because I remember that Rory left because she was going to join the campaign trail of Barack Obama.
That's right.
That's one of the biggest things that bothered me about the revival, because she had such a promising future. She was doing so much crazy stuff. She was, you know, just doing big journalist things. And then we find her at the revival and she's like...
She's floundering,
which she almost has very little reason to flounder. Like, she's got to have a great resume. What's she doing?
Yeah, I mean,
in the background, if you're hearing noises, that's a coffee maker.
She's having that sit down with the headmaster, and he's just mentioning some of the credits that she's had for her writing. And I'm like, well, that sounds like she's been doing pretty good.
Yeah.
I don't know. But it's interesting. That's great. It's interesting
you
because
you have to have coffee for Gilmore.
This is very true. It's interesting because all of the Gilmore Girls in these new episodes are kind of in a moment of crisis and doubt and change and transition. And
you mean from grandma to
Rory,
to Lorelai, to Rory,
right? So it's interesting to see them all. In crisis and figuring it out, and where are they going to go?
Is that why it was seasons? It was about changing?
Oh my God. It could be.
Boy, mind blown.
Like, Emily came out of that junk like a rock star. Oh my God.
So amazing. I almost liked Emily's storyline best of all.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Like, all three of them go through a big change, and it's almost kind of in age order. Like, Emily has the most life experience. She gets the biggest and best change, mm-hmm. followed by Lorelai, and then Rory
right.
kind of, like, you know, spittles out a little bit.
Right.
We're going to talk about this because I'm very disappointed in my girl.
Yeah. Okay. You know, so here's the thing. It's going to be a spoiler-filled morning. If you yep. haven't watched mm-hmm. the episodes, we
Although
are going to be...
Although you're not going to share the last four words.
We're not
going to
talk about the four okay. last words. The tricky thing, though, mm-hmm. is that once you hear those four last words, it makes you rethink so much of what happened earlier in these four episodes. It gives it a perspective that... It almost gives the entire series a different perspective. Because you have to go back and think about so much in relation to these four words.
So is it something that you should be sharing? But we can
no,
do lots
I don't
of
want
spoilers
to.
For
I
the feel like it's before you say
I
it?
I feel like it's too early
okay.
to really talk about it. And yeah. I've been sweating this all weekend. How do we talk about stuff?
Because a lot of people like maybe haven't had the chance to binge yet. It only yeah. came out like 3 days ago.
Right, and it was a crazy weekend to have it happen, you know, to set aside 6 hours, you know.
Well, and some people, like myself, although I don't see this happening... Maybe with all the Gilmore Girl fanaticism that's out there, they're like, oh, I never saw that show, and I meant to watch it. So mm-hmm. they're starting
right.
episode one, series one, yeah. and they're going to run through the whole shebang.
Yeah, maybe.
Which
so,
would take more than a
so
week.
So we'll need like 2 months.
Yeah.
Give them 2 months so they can solid watch it.
But, you know, mm-hmm. Gilmore Gab's going on in the studio. We're drinking coffee. If you are sitting around your kitchen table... or somewhere drinking coffee and you've been wanting to talk Gilmore Girls, now is the morning to do it. Call us or text us. You guys know how to wake up Man Camp. 507-389-5678 is the number to call or text. Or if you want to be lengthy with your opinions and questions, drop us an email at shufflefunction@hotmail.com.
Please do. And honestly, you know, even though we won't be saying what... the final four words of the series are, I know people are going to be all across the spectrum with their emotions about what happened.
Yeah, you can call or text
and I would
mention
love
that.
To have
That's fine. Yeah.
Your ideas on that. Let's play some music, and I have XTC coming up. It's a
Yay.
Solid Gilmore Girls music playlist today, too, and luckily it takes care of itself.
Well,
they had great music on the show.
I always lie when I say I've only seen one episode because I did see the episode that had Yola Tango.
That's right. And
Sparks. And
yeah.
Sparks and who else
Sonic
was?
Youth.
Sonic Youth. I did see that episode because mm-hmm. I have to. Yola Tango is my
of
favorite
course.
Band.
Exactly.
That's even a later episode, too, I think.
I think it is,
I
yeah.
I want to say it. Almost want to say that's... No, there's... That's got to be season 6, because I can't see
It wasn't
not,
season 7.
Yeah, because yeah. Amy Sherman-Palladino could have rounded that kind of firepower up, I think.
Mm-hmm. No.
Not whoever that hack was that took over season 7.
No. It was several hacks, I think.
I think
but
you're right.
But I love
it was
thinking,
Gilmore by committee.
Yeah, I love thinking that so Ira and Georgia probably sat around their TV all day on Friday watching Gilmore Girls.
Oh, yeah. They probably did, yeah. All right, so again, if you have any opinions about the four new episodes of Gilmore Girls, just any thoughts in general, let us know.
Or questions for the experts.
Yeah. Now, Caitlin, I have to apologize. When the show was on, I was like fanatical, and I would watch it over and over and over during its duration, and I was so disappointed by season 7, I really haven't gone back to the show in the last 9 years. So I'm a little rusty on my Gilmore knowledge at times. So much of it is colors and emotions at this point, but I will do my best.
Oh, that's fine. I actually recently just rewatched it.
Oh, good.
Because, like, I think I was working on a comic, and I was like, what's something I've seen a billion times and I won't pay attention to?
Sure.
Which is incorrect. I paid attention to the whole thing. It was detrimental to my progress. But, yeah, just like last year, season 7, and I even rewatched the first couple seasons
uh-huh.
last week.
Awesome. So. All right, cool. Well, this is XTC. I'm the man who murdered love, and you're hearing it on 89.7 The Maverick. Public Radio. 6:30 a.m., 49 degrees. This is shuffle function.
And welcome to La La La. Sing it with me. La 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 Gilmore Camp. It's catchy.
Anyway, that was Tim Curry with "I Do the Rock."
What point in the series did that song play?
Oh God, I don't even know. There's some of these like that XTC song we played. I know that moment just
I'm
like
the
that.
Man Who Murdered Love.
But there's a lot of songs that are just in the background, and you know, I don't know. There's some that are just instantly identifiable, and that is not one of them for me.
A lot of them you could probably just chalk up to be something played in the background in Lane's bedroom.
Because this is very true.
She played everything.
If anybody was going to be playing Tim Curry on that show, it would be Lane.
Okay. That's in her miscellaneous file.
Yes.
And who was Lane?
Rory's friend.
Rory's best friend.
Oh, was she?
Which, by the way, we saw Mr. Kim.
We saw Mr. Kim! He exists!
Oh, he's a real person.
She kept referring to her quote-unquote parents the entire series.
And
I was like, what parents?
We never saw Mr. Kim.
Yeah, you're like half your way to Batman, lady.
Oh, was she the...
You never see her dad.
Because I saw the one episode. Was her parents own the antique store?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Ms. Kim was a terrifying, beautiful force of nature.
Yeah, she's incredible.
I love
she looked
that
amazing,
woman.
Too.
She might actually just be immortal.
Yeah.
She,
Mr. Kim amazing, too?
I don't know what he looked like in 2007.
Yeah, so he's for... Because he's always looked like he's 80.
But if she's a force of nature, was Mr. Kim also a force of nature?
I don't know if anybody's a force of nature against Mrs. Kim.
No, nobody is. No, not even Emily Gilmore.
No, that's
true.
So
is Lane like the character that everybody loves?
Well, I don't know. I mean, she's a really sweet character.
Yeah.
Her parents are very strict. Her mom is very strict. So she has to do things like hide her CDs in the floorboards.
And like go to Bible camp.
She has that closet that's like a disco house. How does that not get discovered?
And like she hides CDs in her floorboards
right,
and stuff.
Exactly.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Like I've known kids like that in high school who had like really strict Catholic parents and that have like their outfit they left the house with, take it off, and they'd have like a band t-shirt or something that was slightly lower than the collarbones for a neck length. So, sinners.
Sure. Totally going
so how did Lane work out in this new series?
She wasn't in it nearly enough.
Yeah, she was kind of just there, but it mostly just focused on like her and her husband and their kids a little bit.
Yeah.
And not even that much.
And not even
so
that much.
She
was
like
sort of like a person that Rory could bump into, and there was like, I think they had one big scene when they were talking about Rory and Logan.
Yeah.
And that was about it.
So
I was hoping for more.
Was she essentially the foil where she's like a happily married person with children? Like
kinda.
Rory should have been?
No, I wouldn't put it like that.
Yeah, not because I don't think that was ever what was necessarily like meant for Rory.
No.
She like constantly, like Lorelai was always like, I want you to have what I didn't have. Go be a career gal and go out and do big things.
Right.
The campaign trail. Which is just like what Lauren Graham sounds like. So
exactly.
I think I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Well, what did we hear before Tim Curry?
It was the Monkees with You Bring the Summer, the smash hit song of the summer, what was also in the new episodes.
Yeah, it was featured in the summer
episode. And another Andy Partridge jam. So we got two Andy Partridge jams in there with XTC and The Man Who Murdered Love. Shout out to Andy Partridge.
That's right.
If you're listening. Welcome to Gilmore Gabs, everybody.
There will be spoilers, so if you have not watched the four new Gilmore Girls episodes, just be aware that there will be spoilers.
If you have watched if you have watched the four episodes and you want to talk to us about it, please feel free to do so.
Yeah.
Call us or text us 507-389-5678 or drop us an email at shufflefunction@hotmail.com and it sounds like Jilly the P might not be making it in to the studio.
Well, she's...
Jilly the P, I hope you're feeling okay. You should just sit on the couch all day and watch Gilmore Girls if you're not feeling
good.
You
sounded a little sick in your text.
Yeah.
I'd take the day off.
I would, too. We can call you in with the plague if you need it.
Yeah. Works every time.
And Mindy, if you're coming, don't bring coffee because there's coffee here.
So much coffee.
Yeah. I already even texted her last night. I was like, I'm bringing a thermos. I'm going to give it to you. So she'll be very...
We've got mugs with your name on it, Mindy. But we'd love to hear from you guys. Mm-hmm. We know that when back in the day, 9 years ago, when Gilmore Girls was on the air, mm-hmm. we got lots and lots of feedback from people.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So we're looking for all you Gilmore Girl fanatics. I saw over the weekend one of my Facebook friends, and I thought, oh my goodness, where can you get this? She had two of those Mexican prayer candles, one mm-hmm. with Rory and one with Lorelai on it.
Oh my gosh! That's amazing!
Etsy.com.
I think it was at Etsy that she got them. But
well, my Christmas shopping's done. Everybody's getting those.
Let us know how you celebrated the Gilmore Girls.
Oh, they're so awesome!
Did you get together with friends and watch it?
Sacred Saints of the Java. Look at that one.
Oh, my God. That is beautiful.
Anyway.
Well, it's coffee scented.
Let's work on one. You actually took notes during the episode.
Which I'm so glad. I actually was able to watch the series twice over the weekend. So I feel like I'm a little fresher on this, but you took notes, and that is awesome.
Yeah.
Do you have any points that you want to bring up right off the bat?
I kind of wrote them in chronological order because I just grabbed my sketchbook while I was going. I was like, this isn't going to stand. So the very first thing I wrote was, there are a couple curse words in it, so I'm not going to say it out loud. But basically just my lamentation of so much Logan Huntsberger.
A lot of Logan.
Just lots of Logan.
I'm not a Logan Is Logan a Rory boyfriend?
He is. Yeah.
He was the last boyfriend. The one that when she was going to Yale.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's not the worst one, though.
Yes, he is.
Because that is, what's his name?
He's pretty bad. I don't like Dean. I'm not a Dean fan.
I'm not
I've
either,
never been a Dean fan. The more time that passes and I think about Dean, I realize, well, he's just being a stupid high school kid.
Yeah.
You know, but at the same time.
Oh, so you're like best friends now?
Yeah. Yeah, we are.
He gets a little bit, he gets a little bit more, you know, of a let off because A, he calls soda pop, so I can forgive him a little bit. Because he's from Illinois.
Uh-huh.
And again, he is a teenage, you know, he's a high school student.
Right.
And he's at least moderately gentlemanlike most of the time, aside from throwing tantrums because she doesn't want to spend every waking minute with him.
Exactly. Yeah.
But like, Logan was in college.
Rory's the worst.
Logan was Logan was, I think at that point, I don't know.
Logan was old enough to know better.
Well, he was definitely old enough to know better. He was kind of a spoiled rich kid.
Is that his real last name?
Huntsberger.
Huntsberger.
Like fancy ketchup.
Of the Huntsberger dynasty.
Ask Caitlin what her last name is now that she's married.
What is your?
Hohenstein.
Wow.
Mm. What and what's the
You can spell it by
name?
Now, right?
Bauman.
Bauman.
Bauman Hohenstein.
So on Facebook, it looks obscenely German. So Bauman Hohenstein.
Are you related to Logan?
No, the Hohensteins and the Huntsbergers, they actually have neighboring castles. So, you know, the Hohenstein, they make a lot of Dijon mustard, and they ship it over to the Huntsbergers.
For their Huntsbergers.
Big German beef industry.
They had the tapestries.
Yes, with the burgers on the hunt.
So Logan was obnoxious in this show, too?
I don't know that I'd say he's obnoxious. It's more the circumstances.
It's more his general presence at this point that offends me.
Yeah, because he was always sort of a smarmy character anyway.
So smarmy. Oh, so he's like one of those guys you see him and you just kind of go,
He's got a punchable face.
He does. He does have a punchable face. Although, if you punch him in the abs, probably wouldn't feel it because, man, abs of steel on that guy.
Might break my hand.
He's in
I'm
great shape.
Really?
Yeah. But I think the thing
I don't see Rory like an in-shape six-packers.
You would think.
Who knows what that girl is thinking anymore? Because obviously she can't quit Logan.
I know. Which, like, I get it. I get it. He's got a certain charm to him.
Yeah.
And he has a lot of money. So she spent the entire revival jet-setting. Like, she's supposed to be broke, like, post-grad who is looking for freelance work. And I'm a freelancer, let me tell you. I'm not flying to London every 2 weeks.
Uh-huh. Although when your quote-unquote boyfriend mm-hmm. is Logan Huntsberger, he probably puts it on the family car.
So they were still together in this.
You know, here's the thing, okay? Mm-hmm. Spoiler alert for The Gray, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
Right off the bat, we're introduced in the series to this tragic character named Paul.
Or Pete,
depending on... nobody remembers this guy. Rory's been dating him for 2 years, and Rory barely remembers him.
So he's a new character.
He's barely even a character.
It's like an anecdote at one point.
Yeah, exactly. And so she is dating Paul, but jetting off
around on Logan's dime,
who is engaged
to Odette.
So they're both
Odette.
Yeah, and so they're both running around.
That's a made up name. Mm.
No, it's in spelled the Swan Princess.
Is that, spelled O-H-D-E-B-T?
Odette.
No, that's what that's what Rory is dealing with.
We're all engaged to Odette.
Exactly. Yeah.
Get ready, because I had a lot of crappy puns coming.
Sweet.
Like earlier.
Wait till Mindy gets here.
Oh, it's going to be bad. Like before when Tam was reading the weather, I was about to just go, I smell snow.
Oh, yeah.
Like Lorelei.
Mm-hmm.
So Peter Paul, that's his name?
Even Rory doesn't remember. She through the whole we're introduced to this guy.
How does he put up with that?
Really, right? Well, he's obviously a very sweet punching bag because he comes over to
Stars Hollow.
Stars Hollow is going to have dinner with the whole fam, and nobody remembers him, but he remembers everybody. He's like, oh, Luke, here's that tool I was telling you about that my grandfather had in his hardware store. And look, the date, it's 1914 or something. And Luke is just like, I don't know who this guy is.
They went on a fishing trip
together. They went on a fishing trip together.
And Luke doesn't remember
they mention Paul to Emily Gilmore, the grandmother, and she's, oh, I must meet him. And Rory said, well, you did meet him.
Several times.
Yeah.
So he's the equivalent of her in Community. Oh, her.
Or even like...
Oh,
what
was the character? Maybe, Arrested Development.
Yeah, Arrested Development. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
You mean like Anne.
Bland. Who, by the way, has a cameo in this show.
She does. She was in The Line, wasn't she?
Yeah.
I was like, honey, what are you doing?
Because I remember
when
they announced the series revival, I remember she campaigned very hard to just get a role in it somehow. Exactly.
Bland.
But he is totally the Bland of this series.
I feel bad for him.
I feel bad for him too. And like every once in a while he would come up and Robert would go, ah, and like at one point she writes something down on a notepad and Jess goes, did you just write down breakup with Pete? And she wrote down Pete instead of Paul because she barely remembers him too. Through the whole series, he's just getting...
She's horrible.
It was horrible.
There's a lot of
She uses Logan for flying around for her
No, she doesn't
She's using him.
She and Logan use each other.
They use each other, but it's not like... I mean, it's a mutual exploitation.
Mm-hmm. So she does freelance writing? Freelance?
Yeah.
She does a little bit.
Right. Okay, she wrote this article that Luke is super proud of that was in the New Yorker.
Yeah, and he like laminates it and puts
it
on the back of the menu. Yeah.
No, spoiler. Are those two married?
No.
They're not.
No, Luke
and Lorelei.
Right. Lorelei? Right.
Yeah, no, they're not. And that really surprised
the series
me.
Didn't end with them getting married?
It ended up with them finally realizing, oh, you know what, we can be together now.
And that makes sense to me because
didn't he say like we have all the time in the world or something like that at the end of that last episode? It was something like that.
It was something like that. And I just remember that they finally kissed or held hands at the very end, like the last exact second of the show. And I guess it kind of makes sense to me because they went through such a roller coaster constantly. And there were so many stupid reasons for not being together.
Yeah.
That I feel like there was almost like a lethargy. I'm glad they were together, but they were just kind of like, screw it. Let's just do this.
Let's just be together.
Let's not bother with a wedding because that always breaks us up.
Yeah.
And they just kind of went with it.
Yeah.
And yeah, they've been together for 9 years by the time the revival comes around.
So they're together.
They're together.
They're living together.
They're living in Lorelei's awesome house.
Love her
they're
house
living
so
in
much.
Sin.
The best.
Living in sin.
Mm-hmm.
Does Lorelei's mother
live in sin?
Oh yeah,
approve of it?
No, she did not.
I was gonna say that sounds very sinish.
But like, not for like the kind of evangelical reasons you would assume. It's more kind of like you need security and you gotta know where the insurance papers are.
Yeah, right.
Don't depend on a man.
Which weirdly. Yeah. Weirdly, Emily Gilmore also talks like a 20s flapper.
Oh, yeah, they all do. Actually, the entire... Even Michelle, who is French, but actually just talks like a 1920s flapper.
And then every once in a while they go, gotta dance!
Make them laugh!
Jilly the P says, Paul, a joke that ran entirely too long, no? I feel like it was a weird joke.
It was.
Because honestly, the whole point of him being in there, I think it just... was to make Rory look really shallow. That's all it did.
And she was kind of, it was way out of her character, too, because she's the most organized. Like, Lorelai used to endlessly mock Rory for her, like, her use of post-it notes and, like, loving going to the office supply store. Really, really organized, valedictorian, top of her class. Forgets to break up with a dude. And it's not like she's, like, socially awkward, really. So she wouldn't have that kind of going for her. She should just call the dude, say, hey, man, don't want to hang out.
Yeah.
Well, and maybe that just, it's he's just in the story to show how off her game she is.
Maybe.
Or she's going through changes, like the changes of the seasons.
I see what you did there.
There you go.
Which, by the way, speaking of Luke and Lorelai, at some point we got to talk about that speech. Luke's speech.
Oh my God,
I know. Tears.
I was already in love with Luke. You don't need to convince me any further. He's the best.
Let's not talk about it now, but oh my God, at some point we need to spend a good 40 minutes just on that moment.
So
seriously, Shelley.
Did she break up with Logan then at some point then?
She did.
Yeah.
She, like,
in this?
They weren't even really dating. They were just kind of like, you know,
each other.
Just banging it out. Mm-hmm. But finally she did finally say, like, we're done. I can't do this. I can't. So,
well, geez, you would think the guy's engaged. That would be,
you know, you would.
It's Logan, though.
Hands off.
It's like he doesn't even care. It's just an afterthought.
Logan is this, has kind of an emotional detachment, I think, from everyone other than himself. There was a period in whatever season where him and Rory took a break for however long, and in the meantime, he made it with, like, six women.
Yeah, he slept with, like, an army of bridesmaids.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm not even exaggerating.
Yeah. Literal army.
A literal army.
Who's worse, Logan or Pete?
Oh, Logan.
Or Logan. Oh.
Pete is a sad, precious
little
lamb.
He's just a sad guy. I don't know how she made it 2 years with him without, I mean, if he's,
like,
that
he's uninteresting,
how is she with him?
How is he uninteresting, though? He sounds awesome.
He is.
He sounds thoughtful. He sounds sweet.
He's quieter than her normal boyfriends, and he's not as immediately charismatic. But still, he was not a bad-looking guy.
Right.
He was awkward and adorable.
Sounds like he's not demanding.
But, you know, honestly,
yeah.
I there's something about him that I think reminds me of a lot of the people that Lorelai dated throughout the series. She had interesting, kind boyfriends that I think were in some ways sort of forgettable, too.
Or maybe he was just kind of like a dummy, like John Hamm's character in, like, the second season when he shows up and dates Lorelai for a minute.
Right, yeah.
John Hamm was in Gilmore
John Hamm was in Gilmore Girls.
A lot of people were in Gilmore
Why
Girls.
Didn't she take him?
She didn't have future goggles. She didn't know.
Let's play some Muzak. I have Merle Haggard coming up with Mama Tried. All music this morning.
Was it Mama Gilmore?
Emily Tried.
All music featured on Gilmore Girls this morning. 3 hours of Gilmore Gab. God, an hour is almost up.
Mama Tried.
We have so much we have not even talked about yet.
So much.
Horrified.
Let us know what you think.
Yeah.
Call or text 507-389-5678 or drop us an email at shufflefunction@hotmail.com. Did you love it? Did you hate it? Have you not watched it yet?
What are you doing?
Yeah, seriously.
Make room for it. Send us all your opinions and your thoughts and your questions this morning.
Absolutely.
For Gilmore Girls.
This is Merle Haggard on 89.7 The Maverick.
I'm going to follow where you lead. I'm going to follow, I'm gonna follow where you lead. I'm gonna follow, oh baby. I'm gonna follow where you lead. I'm gonna follow where you lead.
Oh.
And because I know that the next question everyone has is, where can I get that stuff? I posted on the Shuffle Function Facebook a link to WFMU's Beware of the Blog, where they have not only Robin Kahn doing the entire Carole King Tapestry album. She also does the entire Patti Smith Horses album and Jesus Christ Superstar. So they're all magic.
So that's something that we have heard and Scott probably hasn't.
Oh, yeah.
I bet. I bet he doesn't know about that version.
This changes everything.
Mm-hmm. Do you hear us, Scott Ray? You have never heard that version.
Wow.
I want to hear her Judas so badly.
We played it one year for...
The whole thing
It was the last show of the year on the nighttime edition. I think we played it during Easter, too, because why not?
Mm. But good music for that time.
Anyway.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to hour number two of... La la la
la la la la la la la la la la la la la la la la la la la la Gilmore Gab.
Now let's do it really airy.
Like Yoko Ono.
We're coming to get ya.
Well, that was Robin Kahn with Where You Lead, I Will Follow. Before that, all songs as heard on the Gilmore Girls show. The White Stripes with Fell in Love with the Girl, David Bowie, The Man Who Saved the World, Shown a Knife with Top of the World, and Merle Haggard with Mama Tried.
I'm out of coffee.
Well, oh, my, no.
Get you some coffee.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We've already burned up an hour, and I feel like we haven't talked about anything yet.
How does this work?
There's so much stuff to talk about. We're talking about Gilmore Girls this morning. We're talking about the four new episodes, as well as the seasons in general. Just so you guys know, it's 7:05 a.m., 48 degrees, 50 for your high today, and partly cloudy. A forecast composed mainly of mid to upper 30s for the next 10 days. So...
don't care. Got the Gilmore Girls to talk about.
Michael number three chimed in with a couple of interesting points.
That's Michael McDonald number three.
That's right.
Oh, I'm number 44, buddy.
Number two, right here.
Number three.
And he starts off with a haiku.
No, he's number three.
Mm-hmm.
I'm number five, I think.
He starts off with a haiku.
Okay.
Watching Gilmore Girls, one mystery still remains: empty coffee cups.
Oh, my God. Constantly. The whole series,
yeah.
Too.
He talks about that. He says he's right now him and his wife are watching the original series. They haven't made it up to the new episodes yet. But his wife is constantly screaming at the TV because Lorelai and Rory start waving around obviously empty coffee cups.
Yeah. And, like, I get it. You can't, I mean, there's so many takes, I assume, when you film. That's why they have, like, spit takes.
Right.
Why you can't eat, like, eight pizzas in one scene. I get it. I get it. But they should at least... have liquid in the cups.
Yeah, I know.
And I know that...
That show is the worst.
It is the worst for, like, proper cup weight. And that always bothered me.
You
always.
Know, honestly, even if they didn't have liquid in it, they could put, like sinkers or what are the
like
fishing weights
or something,
in there. Just so it look like they're carrying something of substance.
Because they'd be like waving it around.
They go to Luke's coffee shop a lot, right?
Mm-hmm.
Does he pour, like pretend
Luke's,
to
that's
pour?
That's in the show, right?
Yeah.
Does he pretend to pour coffee or is there actual coffee?
No, there's actual
yeah.
liquid being poured.
Okay. And a lot of the time, and again, this is another thing that I read online, that Alexis Liddell did not like coffee at all. So,
what?
I know.
How'd she even get that part?
She's a heathen, but...
Well, we've already...
But so every...
She's the worst.
So every time there was legitimate liquid in her cup, it was Coca-Cola.
Here's coffee, sir. Oh, it's hot. Careful.
But, like, I noticed that. They didn't even try. Because, like, I'm holding my coffee cup. I have to keep it balanced, at least. They were, like, taking it and just kind of waving it, like, I'm talking,
yeah,
and I'm gesturing.
If, you know, like, even if you have a disposable cup with a topper on it, there's still going to be stuff flying all over
the
place.
Well, maybe they just constantly always drank their coffee, and always empty, needing more. Because
probably.
They're the Gilmore Girls. They're needy.
Well, that's all fine and true, but they would pour it, and the next second they'd be, like, tipping
empty.
At 45 degrees.
Right.
Like, I'm so full of emotions, and so is my cup.
Yeah. There will be spoilers this morning.
Yes.
During the discussions. We will not be talking about the last four words. Although, off mic, a lot of our discussion has been, how do we talk about this stuff and not talk about the last four words?
Get her around it.
Exactly. We're going to do our best. Just talking about Luke's diner real quick. Luke has always had the no cell phone sign in his. He had a whole list of no's
that's
that you
wonderful.
Couldn't.
Mm-hmm.
And I
Good
didn't. I didn't catch all of the things you can't do in Luke's Diner anymore, but I know one of them was man buns. Man buns get a lot of flack during the show. It's even mentioned in Stars Hollow, the musical.
Yeah.
They have they start singing about stuff that's terrible, and they say, man buns.
Yeah, like once they're in like sweater vests, and they're supposed to be like the modern era couple.
Right.
Everything that's wrong, but not in Stars Hollow.
Right.
Oh my god.
So I didn't get the whole list, but I did see that number two was man buns.
I'm gonna need a second watch through.
So you wanted to talk about
Emily and Richard. I mean,
my heart.
Man.
No, he passed away after the series had ended.
Yes.
Within the last year or so.
I think, in the last year.
He passed away, and then they had that reunion at the Austin Film and Television Festival.
Yeah. And he wasn't there for it.
And he wasn't there. And so, you know, he loomed large in everything. He was the stern father figure that Rory just Lorelai wanted his love, and yet she rebelled against him constantly. And, you know, he was everything to Emily, and so him being gone, it's like a mountain has been moved.
I think like a big stern teddy bear that also smoked cigars.
Yeah.
That was Richard Gilmore.
And there were a couple of moments like later on when Rory goes back to her grandparents' house and she's just walking around kind of looking at stuff and they put in footage of like the Friday night dinners, or at one point she opens up the door to her grandfather's office and you see Richard sitting at the desk, and oh my god my heart broke.
I cried so hard.
Yeah.
That
oh
was
my
one
god,
of those
so emotional.
Wrecked.
Yeah, because everybody loved Richard. I mean, if you watch the show, you love Richard. I mean, he could be stern and tough, but he did this stuff. He loved his family.
And they had like sound bites from previous just segments in the show, and his voice is unmistakable. Yeah. So all of a sudden, you're just like, oh god, my heart, I'm dead. Yeah. It's gone.
Yeah. So
So was her story arc for the four new episodes about him being gone?
Well, so much of the show was about grief.
Mm-hmm.
But Emily's storyline, I think, was the most interesting because her transformation was so
drastic.
Radical.
Yeah.
What was it?
Well, she's the grieving widow, and she goes through all the stuff to try and cope. You know, like she decides she's going to do that simplify your life thing
declutter.
If it doesn't give you joy, you throw it out. And basically she's throwing out everything in her life, all her clothes, all her furniture and everything. And until Lorelai says, you know, mom, you're grieving right now. Nothing is going to give you joy.
Yeah, exactly. And like you can already tell at the very beginning of the revival that something is big and changing and off about Emily, because she was always a lovable character, but she did have some like oddness about her, and like she would go through maids like nobody's business.
Right.
She was pretty verbally abusive and
very particular.
Very particular, a perfectionist.
Right.
Pretty, you know, kind of like a hard ass. But
right.
By the time the revival comes around, she almost took solace in like the one maid that she had, and her entire family moves into the mansion.
Who is a lunatic maid?
I think she's played by the same woman who plays Gypsy.
She is. Yep.
I loved it.
I know. She was fantastic.
Gypsy didn't age either.
No,
that woman.
I know. That's one of the things that was so amazing, is so many people
on
the
show.
She runs
She's the mechanic.
Oh. Yeah, yeah.
I think she fell into the same time vortex that Ms. Kim and Emily Gilmore fell into, and they just didn't
even
age.
Babette looked the same.
Babette and Miss Patty looked amazing.
Miss Patty lost a ton of weight. She looks amazing.
She's
so little. Yeah. Anyway.
I don't know. It was time vortex, man.
So we watch Emily. Richard did everything. You know, he took care of the money, he did all this stuff, and so Emily is trying to figure out how to live without Richard, and she goes into hardcore funks where she ends up sleeping till noon, and, you know, she just can't even function. And then by the end of the series, she's just fiercely independent, and she's had it with so many of the trappings of her old life. Like, she was big in Daughters of the American Revolution, and finally she's just sick of all the pretentious artifice of it.
And she has like a very Lorelai-esque tantrum.
Totally.
With the Daughters of the Revolution when they're like going
and
through
swearing.
Oh, it's
awesome.
Beautiful.
So
cathartic.
Beautiful.
Cathartic.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that almost made 2016 okay for me. Just listening to Kelly Bishop curse her little tail off. Yeah. Just going nuts.
Yeah. It was great. And just, she becomes this really strong, independent woman. And except for a few moments, like, there's some moments where she gets really catty with Lorelai.
Oh, yeah.
And you know.
Well, how can you not get
catty? It's cruel. This is true. But, I mean, it's cruel in a very specifically Emily Gilmore way.
It's always kind of like, you know, with certain people, there's always a theory like you're always going to be most unhinged and unfiltered with the people you love the most. So, like, you can be a total jerk to people who, like, are closest to you. And kind of Lorelai and Rory are her closest bonds once Richard's gone.
Mm-hmm.
So, also she's grieving, so she's a little bit unhinged to begin with. But
yeah. And, you know, Lorelai, of course, we find out that something happened after the funeral.
Oh, yeah, Lorelai.
That was just so classically Lorelai.
Mm-hmm.
Everything was going really well. The funeral, so heartbreaking, so sad. And, you know, everybody comes back to...
Oh, so the funeral's in the show?
Yeah, they do like a flashback.
Like 4 months earlier. Oh, okay. Yeah. And they have the funeral. And then afterwards, after most of the people have gone, it's just like some really close friends. They're sitting out behind the house and they're listening to some of Richard's favorite records. And Emily says, you know, it's getting late, but before we all go, let's all share a really great Richard memory. And so people start telling these stories, and Lorelai starts freaking out because she's apparently doesn't have one good memory to share with her dad at that moment. And what she does share is really kind of horrible. It's really more about her than anything else. And I think Emily, for a good reason, is really angry about it.
Yeah, and she holds that grudge for a while.
Yeah.
Which also makes sense for Emily.
Yeah, it totally does.
That was terrible, though. Like, Lorelai was trying so hard not to be next in line to share a story that she almost moved a sleeping man in a wheelchair.
Yeah.
So that he would go before her and she'd have just a little more time to think of
it. But in classic Lorelai fashion, she really just drew more attention to herself.
And I think a lot of it had to do with, and she kind of explained it away a little bit. She was like, I was grieving, I hadn't eaten in 2 days, and I drank a lot of scotch. And did you notice how I feel like the entire revival was sponsored by scotch?
Totally.
Just
so
scotch.
So much scotch.
Scotch. Everybody only drank scotch. I didn't see beer. I didn't see any vodka.
No.
Or
there was a mention, I think, of Emily drinking something in the afternoons.
Like brandy or
brandy
something.
Brandy or something like that. But otherwise, everybody was drinking scotch that whole
all the time.
So I need to start
drinking
more
Amy
scotch.
Sherman Palladino's drink is.
Probably.
Maybe.
Scotch.
Yeah.
Just constant. Like, every time there was new liquor, I was like, bet it's scotch. It's scotch. Oh,
always
look, scotch.
We get it. Really, you like weird scotch.
This is the classy drink. I understand.
Boy.
No 3-2 beer for these people in Connecticut. Mm-mm.
So she had the best story arc, you feel?
Absolutely.
I think so. Her growth, I think, was more remarkable. A lot of what happened with Lorelai and Rory, those stories were still kind of based in the people that they have always been and the lives that they have led. And Emily was more about discovering who she is in this new world that she's in.
And that makes sense because she grew up in a life of privilege and almost got handed off to different situations.
Yeah.
Like, she was a young woman living with her parents, goes off to college, and she even mentions this in an earlier season after she and Richard had been briefly separated. And she said, like, I've never lived alone. I went straight from my parents' house to college to living with Richard. So she got, like, a panic room because she was nervous in her mansion. And to go through all of her life kind of living that way, and then all of a sudden she's opening her home and her heart to these people who she doesn't even speak their same language, and she's like warming up soup incorrectly.
Mystery soup.
Mystery
and,
soup.
And what was the name of the maid?
Berta.
And she made these little puffs, and she didn't know what they were, so she said, can I get you some Berta puffs or some mystery soup?
Some mystery soup? I think there's some mystery soup left in the fridge. Just heat it up.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is, but Berta left it. It's good.
Which was another thing, too, because if this would have been when Richard was still around, she would have been flipping out and like taking heads over things like that. And she's just trying to to get through the day, I think.
And, like, another thing I was kind of thinking of is, if you think of all the characters in the whole show, a lot of them are going through some tough times. Like, Paris is going through some stuff. Rory, of course, is floundering a little bit. And even Lorelai is a little unsure and is kind of dealing with her own mortality a little bit. Mm-hmm. And the person who seems to come out the best with the best growth is the woman who lost her husband at the beginning of the revival.
Right.
Like, she has the most traumatic loss, but she ends up coming over it the best. It's a little crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
Just love Emily.
Ugh. Amazing.
Ugh.
So Paris is in this show?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my, is.
I think,
do you like Paris?
Love Paris.
Paris is amazing. When she was first on the show, she was the villain.
Mm-hmm.
But then her and Rory became best friends.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, Paris is incredible. Paris has one of the best lines is, because Paris, it turns out, she's running a surrogate business, like, for surrogate mothers. And she has this assistant who, right off the bat, she's just, like, tearing apart and fires. And then she says to her, she's leaving, something like, go home and explain to your parents how you got your degree explaining the feminist principles behind Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. They name-dropped Buffy again.
Yeah, there were a couple Buffy references in that show. But Paris is incredible, and she's so Paris.
I always think of, like, the season 2 Paris where she, like, berates this kid for being into the woods. And then she just starts singing, like, into the woods, into the woods, into the woods, until this boy starts crying because she's such a force.
Yeah.
But she's also the character who name dropped Mankato, Minnesota.
That's right.
She did it.
That's right.
In a very obscure way that I don't even think most Mankatoans would understand in perfect Paladino fashion.
We'll explain it. It's because of us.
Yeah, that's right. You had mentioned that you had sent her a letter.
That's right.
And we sent her a t-shirt.
Yep, that's right. And then, like, 4 episodes into the following season, she mentions Mankato on the show.
Because I remember when you told me that.
Because why would she say Mankato?
Exactly.
Why?
It's not a big part of American history. I mean, it's something that you know if you look into the history of our city, right? I'm not even from here, but I'm fascinated with it. But, like, because she says something... like, I will come down upon you like the locusts upon Mankato. I was like, why would you say that?
I know.
What are you talking about?
So obscure and random, which is true to Gilmore Girls, but still.
Yeah. Like, what class at Yale are they focusing on what happened in the mid-1800s in Mankato, Minnesota?
In Little House on the Prairie.
That's true. That's true.
Because I would always, back in the day, say, we're from Mankato. If you read Little House on the Prairie, that's the big town.
The big city.
So I know that I wrote that at the beginning because I always wrote that at the beginning of any fan letter / would you do a station ID letter that we wrote.
Blew my mind when that popped up on the show.
Oh, I think I like sat up straight and was like, what? What? Did we just get name dropped?
All right, well, let's play some music. I'm going to play the Tom Waits song that plays during the funeral scene. So.
No. Oh, what song
so
is it?
So heartbreaking. Time.
Oh.
It's a good one.
Well, they're all good. They're Tom Waits.
Exactly.
I'm so sad.
So we're talking Gilmore Girls, the new episodes, Gilmore Girls in general. If you have any questions or opinions,
Was whatever. That the only time that you cried?
Oh, my God.
Definitely no.
I was crying like a minute into the show.
Oh, okay.
Lorelai's monologue, when she finally talks about her dad and her memory when she was 13.
When she calls her mom.
Oh, my God.
Just so she finally has a good story to share about him?
Yeah, she goes into...
She has the best story.
She flies to California to walk a trail.
She's going
to
do Wild.
Going to do Wild. The book, not the movie.
Yeah, there's
a
difference.
Big deal about it.
Yeah. You know what... Cheryl Strayed, the author, apparently, I don't think she knew that there was all this Wild stuff in the show, and she was watching the series with her daughter and was blown away, and they had, like, a moment, her and her daughter, you know, she said, someday I'm going to explain to you why this scene with Lorelai crying is such a big deal to me, because she got really emotional about it, and then her daughter said, I think I understand, and, like, so the woman that was behind this whole plot point had a moment,
like this almost cult of like middle-aged women who decided to go backpacking. She kind of started it.
It was pretty funny.
It's excellent. Oh, and the guy, one of the park rangers, the one who denies her access to the park, that's her real life
boyfriend.
Her
real life boyfriend.
Real life boyfriend.
And wasn't the other park ranger also a boyfriend on Parenthood of her? I read that somewhere, that they were both Parenthood boyfriends.
See, I haven't watched Parenthood, but I know that her real life boyfriend plays like her brother or stepbrother in Parenthood.
Yeah.
But I don't know about the other guy.
It's not weird.
It's not weird.
Is his name Tim?
Wouldn't that Shabby be something?
Tim? Timothy.
That's what I told Tim that the last four words of the episode is on Friday when we were on it. What was it?
I love you, Tim.
Aww.
She knew it even before she started the whole series.
Yep. So Tom Waits.
Apparently that's not it.
It was not.
We're not going to talk about it.
But that wasn't it.
That's that much we can tell you.
So if that's why you're not watching it, because you just don't want to hear that, that's not it.
Right.
Aww.
Okay. All right. This is Tom Waits with Time. And again, if you have anything that you want to share about the new Gilmore Girls episodes, or if you have any questions or observations or whatever, you can call or text 507-389-5678. Call 1-800-456-7810 or drop us an email at shufflefunction@hotmail.com.
The smart money's on Harlem.
Look at that.
Oh, my God.
Michael number three brought Pop-Tarts up. You are the best.
Thank you.
Ah, oh, now it's perfect.
It's the best flavor, too.
Oh, my gosh. That's fantastic. Who wants a Pop-Tart? You want a Pop-Tart?
I want a Pop-Tart.
What does Pop-Tarts have to do with Gilmore Girls?
Oh, man. Okay, well, first off, they bust off the Pop-Tarts at the end of this series, too. Pop-Tart? Okay.
Oh, I shouldn't eat one. I have a dentist appointment at 9. I'm so angry.
You would take one with you.
I'll take one for the road. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh. Here's your coffee.
Thank you.
Especially in the promo picture, they've got the plate full of, like, interleaved Pop-Tarts with one apple in the center because it's really healthy.
Do you want to sit down, Joe, and talk Gilmore Gab?
Oh, no. It's a long weekend. I can't imagine
how much stuff is
stacked up. Grantley Phillips with Smile on 89.7 The Maverick. For that Dean Martin with Ain't That a Kick in the Head, going out to Lori's dad.
Yep, and Tom Waits with Time.
Oh.
Heartbreak.
So
and plus, you probably don't want to listen to any spoilers.
No, you're right. I'm still a little behind.
we're spoiling it up. Spoiling it for everybody.
Programming supported by the St. Peter Food Co-op and Deli. Give the gift of food this holiday season. The co-op offers fresh ingredients and local artisan gifts. That is how you say that word.
Yeah, not artisanal.
Artisanal.
There's a robot.
Artisanal.
At the place where I work, and she tries to say artisanal, but constantly says, like, artisanal meats.
Yep.
And it's the worst 2 seconds of my life every time.
Co-op offers fresh ingredients, local artisan gifts for your holiday get-togethers. The St. Peter Food Co-op is located on Highway 169 at Mulberry in downtown St. Peter. Remember, everyone is welcome every day. Find out more on Facebook or Instagram, or go to their website at stpeterfood.coop.
One of the things, too, that I loved about, spoiler, Michael number three, that I loved about Luke's Diner was the fact that everybody kept asking for the Wi-Fi password, and he told everybody a completely different password every time because he didn't want them using his Wi-Fi.
I knew something was up. I was like, why does he have Wi-Fi? Why is he letting people use it? That's not Luke. This is a body snatcher. And then every time it was like, oh, it's, you know, Coffee Lou, capital L. Oh, yeah, no, it's like
Butterball,
Wonder Burger, Butterball.
Yeah.
I'm like, ah, it's fishy.
Oh, Luke.
I know, our lovable Luke.
Oh, I'm such a lovable curmudgeon.
Now, this break we wanted to talk because we're gonna wait on the cake talk till Mindy gets here.
We've got a lot to talk about with
hard-hitting cakes. Professional commentary on
which has
cakes.
To do with Suki?
Suki.
With Suki.
Yeah.
And she does some things throughout the series. And Mindy and I are professional cake decorators. We have to talk about this when she gets here. We're both very upset, and we have been for years. This is
Amy
very
Sherman
serious.
Amy Sherman-Palladino, I hope you're listening.
We love you, and we love your work, but you let us down.
Thank you.
Thanks.
But we're going to talk about the musical.
Stars Hollow the musical.
And oh,
Kirk.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Is it Kirk or Kurt?
Kirk.
It's Kirk.
Kirk is perfect right off the bat. Kirk is Kirk.
Just he's beautiful. He's flawless. He never changes, and I love him for
it. Yeah. Oh my God, he's amazing. Him and he's so lucky to have found Lulu.
Yes.
Oh my God,
Lulu,
who must be the most patient woman in the world.
Yeah. You almost think
that's
like
his wife.
Yes.
Yeah.
Or even if they're not married, it's his partner. They've been together since like season five,
yeah.
maybe.
Yeah.
I remember
they
Luke
were together
because
I rewatched the end of season four, and she was in season four, so they were together that early. But one of the great things, right off the bat, you find out that Kirk has a pet pig, and the reason
petals.
and you find out the reason that Kirk has this pig is because the town was concerned that him and Lulu were going to have kids, so they got him a pig so they wouldn't procreate; they'd be too distracted by a pig. The whole town doesn't want Kirk to procreate.
They were even saying like that'll buy us a couple years.
Yeah, right.
Jeez. And he does, like, he takes petals with him everywhere. He makes petals like the center of his short film. And like, so in the short film, Petals gets hit by a car, but it's very shoddy, like special effects. And in the final scene where he's like holding what is presumably Petals,
it's like a stuffed animal pig.
And then like Petals, actual Petals, is like at his feet, like hanging out, like, what's up, guy? And they have to like shoo him out of the shot, but they don't edit it out.
It's great because they, at the bookstore, they're going to have a double feature. It's going to be Eraserhead.
Oh, God.
And Kirk comes out beforehand wearing a Jack Nance Eraserhead wig. Amazing. Oh. But beforehand, they show this short film, Kirk's second short film.
I made a note about Eraserhead, too, because why was Eraserhead Lane and Zach's makeout film? What were they doing?
That's disturbing.
Guys.
When I saw Eraserhead, I was convinced it was made by the government to have kids not have unprotected sex.
Seriously, it's a total birth control.
Oh my God, it's the least sexy film.
Because if you have unprotected sex, that's what comes out of you.
That's what happens.
That's right.
Little whatever that is.
Eraserhead, baby.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Or in Lane's case, you do it once, you get twins, you're all done.
Exactly.
Never again.
So Kirk is awesome.
Kirk is always awesome. Yep.
Kirk is
he's fantastic.
A constant. He's an absolute good.
What is he doing other than
he has a thing at the
pig owner?
But then he also has a role too in decorating Lorelai and Luke's wedding, and it's just a beautiful, beautiful moment, and it kind of gives you the absolute perfect finale for Kirk's character too.
Yeah, like he constantly, and he has a theme throughout the series where he just kind of messes up all the time. Like
starts these businesses, different career choices,
the business venues, the fake Uber cab company that he starts.
It's not Uber, it's Uber.
Uber with multiple O's.
Yeah.
But even it's kind of parallel to that time that he helps Taylor decorate for Easter, and he has to hide a bunch of eggs, but he hides a bunch of them like for himself. He's like, well, I want a good chase too. So he hides them like up above in trees or in places kids can't reach, but then he forgets where he hid them.
Uh-huh.
So the whole town is trying to find these disgusting, smelly eggs. And so it's paralleled in the end of the revival. Like, he comes to Luke and he's like, I messed up. I messed everything up.
I ruined your wedding.
I ruined it all, but it looks gorgeous.
Yeah.
So he didn't actually mess it up.
It was perfect.
And tell me about the musical.
Well, so true to Gilmore Girls, there's a festival going on for every single thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, the four episodes are spring, summer, winter, fall. And they have a festival going on in all of them.
Mm-hmm.
For the summer one, they to bring in tourism dollars, they decide they're going to have Stars Hollow the musical. Written by Taylor.
Perfect.
And music by this weird, sullen, I don't know what that guy's deal is.
Oh, man.
The guy that wrote the music just kind of sits in a chair, virtually catatonic, and clearly something's wrong with him.
He doesn't have a line.
No.
He makes eye contact with people a few times and just kind of just, that's about it.
Rory describes him as a White Walker.
Yeah, like give him a sword.
Right, exactly.
He kind of looks a little half dead, mostly dead. Like Billy Crystal could bring him back with one of those chocolate pills, but
is the music good?
Oh, it's so wonderful. I wish that I had it to play.
Are they going to put it out on like Record Store Day?
I don't know, but that would be incredible.
I
want to see a full musical. So
I memorized part of it.
Do
you want to sing it?
The star of it is Sutton Foster, who was the lead in Bunheads. Did you ever watch Bunheads?
I remember when it was on, but I didn't.
It was kind of like a low grade Gilmore
familiar.
Girls,
but
she was the star, right? She was the star of Bunheads, and she's the star of the musical, and. There are all these scenes that relate to the history of Stars Hollow. somehow.
Like through the ages.
Yeah. It starts off with this weird kind of working class scenario that implies things like alcoholism and spousal abuse.
Yeah. Like she's got like a black eye in the first scene. And
they find a way to use the word encomium. But then it breaks into this Revolutionary War song. Where the two main characters, they're singing about their life and all the stuff that they bring to each other. And then you find out that they're actually brother and sister, but it's not illegal yet.
Yeah.
And they're gonna have 14 kids and hope that three of them survive.
Yeah. working on building oh my stars, God. Hollow.
Oh, so great. Oh. Amazing. And then they move on to that. There's the next song where it's the contemporary period, isn't it? Is that the next period after that?
I think shortly after. Like
there's the Industrial Revolution.
The Industrial Revolution.
This sport by James Naismith will never catch on. What's it called? Basketball. but that's the point where they have a guy come in and rap about going on strike, but the rap is really more about how they rap in Hamilton.
Yeah, they're like, it worked for Hamilton, so we can do it.
Yeah.
Oh, God, no.
But then they move on to contemporary Stars Hollow, and they just do a song about all the bad stuff you're not going to find in Stars Hollow, like man buns.
Mm-hmm.
And I forget all the other things.
Just lots of like trendy stuff that, of course, Taylor would hate.
Right, exactly.
And then they also mention that they have the brand new sewer system.
That's right, because early on he wants to get a new sewer system.
That's alleged.
And then, of course, they break into a kick line.
Oh, yeah.
And they leave the stage, and there's like this is all shown at a like an advance performance for the advisory committee, so they can give notes on the play. Lorelai hates it, which I don't think she would. This is everything she loves about Stars Hollow, is how weird this play is. I don't mm-hmm. think she would hate it. But after the last song, they she stands up and she's going to give some notes, and then the spotlight comes on and the cast comes out and starts performing Waterloo. And it turns out that they actually end it with like 9 ABBA songs.
Let's just fill this with ABBA.
Yeah.
Which is what every good play should do.
Exactly. But the play was wonderful. I want to see the whole thing. I just loved it. It was so funny.
I would really love it, since I doubt they would do any continuation of this revival. I would throw all of my excess money, which is not a lot, but any amount of money at them just releasing the play.
I feel like if they did a Kickstarter right now, they would get the money in about 10 seconds.
Put it on Broadway. I will buy a plane ticket right now. I will audition to be in it. I will be an extra. I will just be in the kick line. I don't even care.
The episode with the play, the musical, also had a lot of cameos by Carole King, who did the theme song. And when they're at the advisory meeting and they're talking about how Taylor says, well, we found out that we'll get sued if we use 9 ABBA songs at the end of it. So I don't know what we're going to do with that. And Carole King says, you know, and she's not playing Carole King, but she says, you know, I wrote some songs. You can use them for free if you want. And so she gets up to start playing one. She starts playing I Feel the Earth Move, and everybody hates it. So she's like, okay, whatever.
That's kind of the same thing with like that the leading lady who was on Bunheads, she sang that one solo song that was very heartfelt.
Oh, yeah.
And I know it was a bit cheesy, but I loved it. That was one of the ones.
So
cried.
Yeah,
cried.
They to replace the ABBA songs, they wrote a new song, and it was the lyrics were like, something like I'm unbreakable. Yeah. And it was really emotional and
Lorelai like loved it.
And like the last line is if not never now or something like that. And that's the moment where, you know, Lorelai's breaking down. She's looking at all the stuff that's going on in her life, and she's kind of having a meltdown and just realizing this song is for her. And she goes back to the house and tells Luke that she's going to go do Wild.
Wild, yeah. And the rest of the committee is like, well, we're going to cut that one. That's a bad song.
Right.
She has this big cathartic, like, soul-searching moment, and she's, like, standing ovation, loving it, and then, like, Babette's like, well, that was garbage.
But it was amazing. Yeah, there's so many moments during this series that it just really hit all the right notes.
When else did you cry?
Man. Oh, jeez.
Right off the bat.
What?
The funeral.
The
wedding.
The wedding was beautiful. I mean, even, like, in the
Luke's
flashback.
Luke's speech.
Oh, God, speech.
That speech.
Was it his speech that he gave at the wedding?
No, it was he. Lorelai came back
from the wild
trip, and he thought the reason she was doing this is because she was going to leave. Because all he knew was that she was leaving, and he had this sit down with Jess and was talking about it, and they're both like, it sounds like she's going
to
leave.
Well, to be fair, that's within Lorelai's track record. Like, she freaks out and she bolts. That's the thing that she does, even when things are not that bad. She's like, I'm restless. I got to leave. I got to just branch out.
Mm-hmm.
I gotta,
again, like a 20s flapper.
Got to run in the wild, and I got to...
Got to dance.
Got to do some mescaline in the desert. You know, stuff like that. It's very Lorelai. So she comes back, and he, like... almost kind of jumps on her. He's like, I know you want to leave, but here's why you shouldn't. And he professes so many sweet things.
This has gone on so long, and we watch each other bounce back and forth to other people. Mm-hmm. But what all we need is what's here right now. And if you need this, I will do it. And, but we can't give up. And it's just an amazing speech. And it's just like pouring out of him. And she's just standing there trying to get a word in edgewise. But he's like, no, let me finish.
Mm-hmm.
And then... when the speech is done, she says, I think we should get married.
And she had it all planned out.
She planned
it. She doesn't say, you had me at...
No.
You had me at... Hello.
You had me at shut up. Yeah, and she had planned the wedding. Like, by the time she got back, she planned everything so he wouldn't even have to worry about it.
Which is nice, because that shows him, like, she's not just being persuaded by what he just said.
Right.
She was already planning
on staying.
She was
already there.
She's ready to go.
Ugh.
And then Luke said no.
He was like, no. He said, will you hold still? That could have been the last four words, in my opinion.
Will
it
you
should
hold
have
still?
Been. Because that's what he said to her when they first kissed.
Oh, that's right! Yes!
He came to the opening night of the Dragonfly Inn.
Yes.
And they had been bouncing back and forth all the time.
It was
and
so
she had
sweet.
Just broken up with Jason for the final last time. And he kissed her, and she like...
No, he starts going in, and she goes, what are you doing?
Yeah!
And then he says, will you hold still?
And then she kisses him, and he is like, what are you doing? And she's like, will you hold still? Oh, God.
So good.
So perfect for them. They're so awkward. I love
I'm
them so
cry.
Much.
Yeah,
you should. You should cry. You got to start emoting with us, Shelly.
It's hard because I'm not as attached.
Yeah.
Yeah, you just gotta go binge watch. You gotta watch the rest of it. Oh man, it's so good.
So good.
Let me just ask you this. Which season was the best?
It's hard to say. There's so many moments in all the seasons up through episode 5. Episode 6, season 6, sorry. Like when Lorelai and Rory had that falling out.
Yeah,
that
was
weird.
That was a mess.
And I remember we were talking to Ira Glass at that time. We did an interview with Ira Glass and we were talking about it. He's like, this doesn't make sense.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know, I enjoyed a lot of it throughout the entire series. I mean, it was kind of hard to get through season 7 and find stuff that I liked, but I think my favorite bits were while she was still in high school.
Yeah.
I especially liked in season 3, like, her rapport with Jess, even though Jess was a total butthead.
Yeah.
Just a butthead. Mm-hmm. I appreciated their interaction with each other, Rory and Jess, and that was my favorite Rory. Rory, after, once she started Yale, she was pretty intolerable. She, for me, mm-hmm. she made a lot of mistakes, she made a lot of decisions, and I was like, honey, what are you doing? What are you doing to me? It's like she had every opportunity at hand, and she still messes it up.
So Jess was not in the show enough, as far as you're concerned?
I would have liked to see more.
Yeah.
And Dean was in it just the perfect amount?
I think he was in it the right amount. Yeah, I don't think I would have wanted any more. Dean. I was worried there was going to be a big story arc with Dean, and he's just like needs to go away.
Mm-hmm. Like, Dean was in it the amount that I would have preferred Logan to be in it.
Yes.
Yes, and Logan was in it the amount I would have preferred Jess to be in
totally.
It.
Totally.
Dang it.
But the moments that Jess was in the series, they were gold.
He was so helpful.
And he was so mature. Mm-hmm. And like, he's like, he wants to, when Luke was clearly having a meltdown over Lorelai, he's like, what's going on? Let's sit down and talk. And he wants to talk stuff out. Whereas if it would have been season 3, Jess, he would have probably like burned down Luke's diner. Because that would have been his reaction.
He got in and he Gandalfed it up.
Yeah.
He led everybody to better life choices. He moderated or mediated, I guess. He was great.
Yeah, he was really awesome. And he was the one that came up with the book idea.
Yeah,
which
was,
you know, with all the floundering that's going on with Rory, not knowing what to do, her career's not going where she wanted. She's kind of bouncing from couch to couch, mm-hmm. and he says, you know, this is what you do. You should write a book about you and your mom. It has a point of view. It's a great story. And Rory immediately realizes, yes, absolutely, this is mm-hmm. the thing that I should do.
Which is good. It sounded like a good direction for her.
Yeah.
And I don't know. We're all pretty, like, creative types here. I hate that phrase so much. But, I mean, it's applicable in this scenario. And I know how hard it can be when you've got, like, art block or writer's block. So I get where Rory's coming from. Like, she's got a huge case of writer's block. But then, like, she just kind of jumps on it. And that's exciting. Because she, like, wrote the first three chapters in, like, a night and just whips it out. And that's great. Mm-hmm. But then as soon as she gets the idea, she goes to Lorelai. She's like, I'm looking at apartments in Queens.
I know.
I'm going to move now. I suddenly have all the expendable income to get an apartment in Queens. Like, girl, where are you getting this from? What are you doing?
From her Logan Club.
From her Logan. Or her, like, dad or her grandmother. Everybody in the club is rich in this show.
Yeah.
Except for Kirk, who is a struggling businessman.
Oh, you know, one other thing that was a nice kind of subtle thing was Lorelai's dog is named Paul Anka. She has a dream about Paul Anka where she gets up to go check on him and the actual Paul Anka is like in the kitchen or he's in the yard and he says something. He goes, squirrel.
Yeah. She takes him out to the yard so actual Paul Anka can do his business.
So funny.
Oh, it was wonderful.
Honestly, everything, you know, and you know, we haven't even scratched the surface on so much of this series, but I had to say, this was exactly what I wanted. Everything for me hit all the right notes.
Now, I've seen some Facebook posts of people saying they hated it.
I didn't hate it. I loved it, frankly. Things happened that I didn't want to happen.
Right.
But that's kind of how life goes, you know? My biggest disappointment was just in the constant choices that Rory made.
Yeah.
Because she is, in the first part of the series, you know, before the revival, she is usually, especially in the earlier seasons, a voice of reason. Like, she's always kind of calling Lorelai out, saying, like, okay, you're being a little ridiculous. We gotta just calm down and make a better decision here. And then, I don't know if it's part of her coming of age, but she constantly messes up.
Yeah.
Like, she does everything within her power to just make poor decisions. And that's, I don't know, you have to just kind of accept it because people aren't always going to do what you want them to do.
Yeah.
Maybe that's part of the show's audience is also growing and realizing... Well, sometimes, you can't put Rory in a corner.
Sometimes it's easier to tell people what to do and not look at yourself because you're not being honest.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's Rory and Lorelai. I have no idea. But
it could be because they're so similar.
Yeah.
So Emily's story arc is her husband dies and she has to become independent. Mm-hmm. Is Lorelai's story arc... She goes on the wild walk and then she gets married?
Well, no, she goes on the wild walk because of everything that happened. Because the Dragonfly Inn is kind of stagnating. Mm-hmm. Michelle is realizing that and he's going to leave the inn. He's great, of course.
I love Michelle. And Suki's gone. Kind of floundering too.
And so she's kind of, this dream of hers is stagnating and she's running it all by herself practically. Mm-hmm.
And she's fighting with Rory.
She's having concerns about her and Luke, which were, of course, instigated by her mom.
Emily.
Yeah. And so
then she goes off on the wild
walk. She goes on the wild walk because she wants to try and figure stuff out. And then we probably at some point should talk about that phone call.
Oh, yes.
So good.
Because she finally kind of thinks of a story of her dad, like a year late.
Yeah.
But better late than never.
Exactly.
Let's talk about that when we come back.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have the Velvet Underground coming up with I'll Be Your Mirror. All music from Gilmore Girls today because it's 3 hours of Gilmore Girls talk.
Yes.
On 89.7 The Maverick. And if you have any opinions or comments or questions about the new series or about Gilmore Girls in general, we'd love to hear them. Call or text 507-389-5678. Call 1-800-456-7810 or drop us an email at shufflefunction@hotmail.com. Just want to say thanks again to Michael Number 3 for the s'mores Pop-Tarts.
Yeah, they're very good.
So good.
Excited.
Not even toasted, and they're good.
Oh. Mm.
That you was, can even freeze those.
Mm-hmm. Oh, see. Mm-hmm. That was Carole King with Where You Lead, I Will Follow, and the Velvet Underground with I'll Be Your Mirror. And welcome to hour number three already of Gilmore Gab.
Gilmore Gab!
La, 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 la. La 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 Gilmore Gab.
God. Instant.
You've
classic.
Done it all time. Every time you've done it.
That's right, I have.
And every time you go.
Every time. Because it deserves the same Jeez. Respect every single time.
You gotta have more pride in your Gilmore Gab song.
Gilmore Gab.
Next time I'm gonna add harmonies, so just hold on to your hat.
You, there will be no more next time.
Well, we'll have to make a point at the bottom of the hour.
Maybe when Mindy's here, she'll want to sing along with it.
Man.
Yes.
We are talking about the Gilmore Girls revival. Mm-hmm. Is that what it's officially called?
Yeah.
It's like a church event.
A year in the life.
Yeah, right. That's the subtitle of it.
If the Gilmore Girls was a church, would you go to it?
Totally.
Oh, I'd be like a bishop.
I feel like it'd be a very forgiving but kind of also judgmental church.
Oh, yeah. Especially for the office of the church called the Kelly Bishop.
Oh!
Oh!
Yes!
Good one. Is that a character?
Yeah, she plays Emily Gilmore.
Kelly Bishop does.
A little bit of a Catholicism joke there for you.
Good one.
Early in the morning.
Wow.
Now, we've been talking about Gilmore Girls since six.
Yeah.
Yes.
You want to talk about the call that Lorelai makes from the wild to her mom after totally bombing her chance to share a story about her father.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In episode one, we find out that there was a moment where Emily asked everyone to share a story, a fond memory of Richard, her husband, who passed away. And everybody tells these great stories except for Lorelai, who tells one about getting busted having sex in the pool house or something like that by Richard, and Richard getting angry, or playing hide and seek with her and then she hid in the steamer trunk and he went off to
like Belgium.
Belgium. And
so not the stories that
not fond stories at all.
Like more, calling him inattentive.
Right. Exactly. So Lorelai's off on this soul searching trip. She's gonna go for the wild hike. And or the walk. Does she call it a walk?
Yeah. She wasn't going to hike it.
Right.
She's going to leisurely walk it.
Which I'm kind of glad that you didn't see the scene where she was in the hotel room trying to pack, because you would have gone nuts.
Oh, man.
Not a good packer, that
no.
one.
Oh. Just loose snacks. Loose stuff everywhere. Cramming them. At one point, she just started duct taping bags of chips to the outside of her pack.
Yeah, it was ridiculous.
Like, the bears would have eaten her within the first 3 hours.
Totally. It was funny, though, because she went to she was staying in this hotel, and then morning comes, and she walks out, and as she's walking out with her backpack on, all these other doors down the way open up, and all these women with backpacks on start walking out, because they're all going to do the wild hike. Mm-hmm. And the park ranger even gives a speech that's basically like, some of you are going to die.
But for those of you who don't, here's what you should be ready for.
Right. So good. But she goes on this hike, and you know, it's not gonna happen. She can't find her pass, so she can't go out on the hike. So she puts her backpack by a dumpster with a free sign on it, drives off. She's gonna go someplace to get some coffee. The place is locked up, so she walks around the back of the building and she sees this panorama of gorgeous rolling hills, and she has this moment of clarity, and she calls her mom and she tells who is sleeping. And she tells her mom this story about when she was 13 and she was being ridiculed at school to the point where she had to leave. She was she thought she had a boyfriend, and then it turned out that he was only dating her because he wanted to make someone jealous, and then he belittled her and said things like, you're actually the gardener's daughter and your mom bought you, and you know, and this is in front of a bunch of elitist kids. So she went and ran to the mall, and her dad, who never goes to the mall, happened to be at the mall that day. And he was so furious with her. Like, why aren't you in school?
There's Mindy.
Ah! Mindy!
We're talking about Lorelai's phone call.
Yes, the heartbreaking monologue.
So So she tells a story. She tells her dad everything that happened, and she's just a mess. And when she finally gets the courage to look up at her dad, he's standing there with a couple of big pretzels.
Yeah.
And then they go to Greece and an unmarried woman.
Yeah, a movie for her and a movie for him.
Oh, I thought you meant the country Greece.
Yeah. No.
They travel to Greece.
That would make sense, I suppose.
And they have tea with Olivia Newton-John, right, who was a married woman.
Right. Yeah. So they go to these movies, and then they go home, and they never told Emily about it.
Just between them.
And Lorelai tells her mom this, because this is the story. This is the mm-hmm. fond memory. And Emily thanks her. And then it was just like a really good moment. I think it's a moment that they needed mm-hmm. to have, because they were going to therapy, actually, for a little bit, which right there could be an entire series of just those two in therapy.
Also, if you notice, like, that scene after Lorelai calls Emily, that is the last time you see Emily sleeping in.
That's true.
She gets out of bed then, turning point.
Yep, it's exactly right. And she buys this house in, I don't know, Fancy Town, USA.
Nantucket,
yeah.
Emily does?
There once was an Emily.
She moves from
like a beach house, and she's out there, and she goes to tour this whaling museum, and then eventually she's like, I am going to... She becomes a tour guide at this whaling museum and telling these horrible stories to groups of school children about harpoons with explosive devices in it and how they'd cut the tendons in the whale's tail so it couldn't swim. And the parents and kids are just like, aah! And Emily, she says something like, I'll give you a moment. And she just stands back proudly while she's traumatized perfect. These kids other than her own.
Oh, my God.
Oh. That was part of her transformation into like a really incredible independent woman.
It made me so happy.
Oh, it was the best.
Thank goodness you are here, Mindy, because we need to talk about Suki and Cake.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, we've been waiting for this. Mindy's here, everyone.
I was listening at home, and I was like, yeah, you wait. I am coming.
So Suki is a conspicuous absence throughout all of the episodes until the end of the fourth and final episode, where
5 minutes.
Yeah, where Lorelai goes back to the Dragonfly Inn and she walks into the kitchen and she sees a bunch of wedding cakes everywhere. Oh. And she's like, Suki. And Suki pops up with a
piping bag.
Yeah, piping bag.
Would this be her wedding cake? Lorelai's wedding cake?
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. She pops up with a piping bag and spews frosting everywhere, and Suki says, well, that was pornographic.
Yeah. Perfect Suki entrance.
So good. Yeah. But there are all these cakes. Now, I'm going to just turn this over to you guys, because I feel like, you know, we have 45 minutes, so play with it.
Yeah. We have a lot to say. So, Mindy, do you want to begin?
Caitlin and Mindy, professional cake decorators.
You work at Hilltop High View.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well.
Oh, well.
Well. I mean, to go even throughout the whole series,
yes,
how Suki just like...
just has several tier cakes around.
Yep, just whips them up.
In her hot kitchen.
And what's
around
in a tier cake?
Like around vegetables and meats, raw meats.
Yep.
They're just done. Like as if that's the way we work. We just have just tiered cakes sitting in the center of a busy kitchen.
Yep. Fact that, you know, they're having weddings there that weekend. And she's like, well, I haven't decided on the cake yet. Because the bride and groom have no say.
Like, as if it's not decided months in advance. Yep. As if the brides don't pour over that decision and agonize over it. I think I'll do red velvet. I don't know.
Yeah. drives me nuts. But Lorelai walks in and there's like 15, I don't know, tiered cakes, just all decorated completely
everywhere.
Different.
Mm-hmm.
That would be hours and hours.
Oh, yeah, but it's Suki, so she can just go like, and they're done.
Yep, and she goes, well, I started with this one, and then I didn't know, and then so I made this cake with cakes on the cake. I made this cake that says Luke on it.
Literally says Luke.
Literally says Luke.
Nobody wants that for a wedding cake. Suki.
Well, and then the funny thing is that the one that they finally kind of decide on is like a sheet cake.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A sheet
with like weird, awkward fondant bits on it.
Yeah, yeah. Of like moments in their life, and even like when Suki got her finger cut off, and that's on there. Did you see there was the one thing about Duluth?
I did.
What was that?
Like, does that say Duluth on it?
It says Duluth. What is that?
I don't know.
There's some kind of Duluth
thing. Must be another fan letter.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
Like, what is their, like, very subtle, you know, love affair with Minnesota that they never quite talk about? Are we, like, their hidden significant other they don't want to really assess during the series? Because they talk about Mankato and the locusts.
Right. Whatever it was with Duluth, it was important enough to end up on the wedding cake.
Yeah.
So that's why I want to know what the deal is.
Something. But then it's not just that. Like, Suki, throughout the series, she does some things with cakes that don't make any sense. But let's talk about that bakery that is not where Suki works.
Oh, is this the one where they went to taste the cakes?
To taste the cakes. We have a problem with that.
They are just horrible people.
Yeah.
Marla and Rory.
Yeah, yeah.
Just the worst.
Yeah. They're totally exploitive of that poor woman behind the case.
Oh, do they start with, I need to try this icing or this icing? Just because
just
they want to eat
icing? It's like
every
6-inch double, like, fondant covered cakes, like, of all different flavors.
Like, finished decorated cake rounds covered in fondant. They take hours to make. Just that. Baking all those rounds.
Making fondant.
Fondant, rolling it, covering the cake.
And then you don't want to eat fondant.
No.
Tastes like Play-Doh.
And they're just trying all these cakes. And were they even going to get the cake there?
Nope.
No. Suki was doing it.
Yeah, Suki was doing it. They were just being completely exploitive.
They just wanted to eat cake.
Yes.
Yeah. Which, you know, they're the Gilmore Girls, so they can eat and eat and eat cake and never gain any weight.
That's, yeah.
That's
yeah.
your coffee being made by
Oh!
Yeah, right. Isn't it beautiful? But it just upsetting because it gives people a false idea. When you get cake samples for your wedding, they don't come like that.
No.
And we will charge you. I'm not going to cover 8 different 6-inch double rounds and have gourmet flavors so that you guys can just mess around, taste a few, and be like, just kidding, my best friend is going to make it at the inn that I work at.
Yeah.
How dare you?
They are the worst.
There are a lot of things about them that truly are the worst.
I love them, but they are terrible.
Oh, yeah. They really are.
Oh, my.
God.
Well, Mindy, you've been listening to us. Is there anything that we haven't covered that you really want to go into detail about?
Because I feel like there's so much yet to talk about, even know what it is that we haven't talked about yet because we've just been rambling.
So much. I still have a list, too. So if you can't think of anything, read my chicken scratches or just whatever you want to talk about.
Well, I know I heard about the musical. That was just beautiful.
Oh, God, I loved it.
And you mentioned the Parenthood cameos.
Yep.
Yes.
Yep. No, they were both boyfriends, right, on Parenthood? The Josh Ritter and...
He played the boyfriend on the show, yes.
And then the other one was her brother.
Yeah, who
is
his
boyfriend in real life.
Yeah.
And
very
then messy.
Her daughter from Parenthood was on the show as well.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, because she was the daughter.
Yeah.
That's right. Bland.
May Whitman,
Bland.
Who's also on Arrested Development.
Right, yep. She was her daughter in Parenthood?
Yes.
Yeah, I forgot about that. Because here's the thing. When Parenthood started, I watched the first episode because I thought, yes, weekly Lauren Graham again.
Mm-hmm.
And then she wasn't Lorelai, and I couldn't get past it.
Because
I was, I'm still so in love with Lorelai. I just couldn't watch it.
I'd like to think Lauren Graham is just Lorelai all the time.
I think she
is. She's very similar.
Did either of you guys read the novel that she wrote?
No.
Because apparently the way it's written, so much that cadence of Lorelai, which I think is just how Lauren Graham speaks. Her book about Gilmore Girls comes out tomorrow, incidentally.
Do you need cream or sugar?
I'll take it black.
I'll take cream.
Because I'm actually going to drink coffee, not just have an empty cup.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Yeah. That
Guys.
Was the other thing you mentioned that bothers me. Like, oh, what?
Like, they just filled it, and then they're, like, shaking it around.
You know, the other thing, because we had Michael number 3 chime in about the empty coffee cups thing. He said the other thing that he's been doing is keeping a tally of how often the same 3 cars drive by in the background.
Of course, because
spoken like a gearhead.
He did not notice that.
Yeah.
Owns Miller's Modern Garage. So he noticed cars.
They can play like 1, 2, 3, he's yours with the cars.
Oh, yeah. That's why he went to that, the movie that we showed with that was supposed to be like the JFK assassination. Because he wanted to see the cars.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Is this the appropriate tan for your coffee?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Does it look like He-Man? Because that's supposed to be the gauge. Like,
or
it looks like He-Man's skin.
All right, cake decorators, monkey tummy?
Monkey tummy.
Okay.
That's
I
a
like
good
a
name for
a little darker
beige.
Than monkey tummy.
Okay.
Okay.
Gonna have a nice bite, as James says. Of course,
do we have a Pop-Tart for Mindy?
Oh, you know what? We do.
Pop-Tart.
Yeah, Pop-Tart.
So, Pop-Tarts.
It seems like everybody had like their big speech. Luke had his I love you speech. Oh, yes. Emily had her swearing speech.
Oh,
that was so good. Was the start of the revolution.
Was Lorelai's speech the phone call?
Yeah.
Yeah, it totally was.
What was Rory's speech?
I feel like it was maybe when she gave Logan the big kiss off.
Was it? It was very brief.
It was very brief, but I think maybe that was her moment.
Because I don't know, it didn't feel to me like she had the same kind of cathartic, like, big monologue. It was almost like little mini-logs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, just dropping them here and there. Because I know that she had one with Jess, like, I don't have any underwear.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. God. Thing, like, probably, I'm just floating.
Probably because Rory didn't really grow or change at all.
Yes.
That's true. That's
so,
very
like,
true.
You can't really have a changing speech
right.
if you don't change.
She had a mini monologue after she had the one night stand with the Wookiee.
The Wookiee, yeah.
She had a little bit of a breakdown, mm-hmm. and I do enjoy the breakdowns.
Speaking of breakdowns, nobody has a better breakdown than Paris.
Paris,
who's just this force of nature and is always super confident and just like a dominating presence, when she breaks down, she is spectacular. And they yeah. had a Chilton alumni event where all these former Chilton students go back and they walk around the school and they address the students. And by the way, Paris saying, I don't normally quote Stalin during
oh
hers.
Oh my God, it was perfect.
Was amazing. But she sees Tristan, who was in first season, the worst human being.
Oh, friggin' the worst.
Tristan is the worst. And
as bad as Logan.
Yeah, really bad. And
pretty
and
much just like Logan.
She yes, yeah.
was Tristan's.
Tristan was this dude who was just like this smarmy, snotty kid who kept calling Rory Mary, and
yeah.
he kept pursuing.
So not a boyfriend, just a
no. Although I think it they were always kind of implying maybe that something was going to happen, but she was mm-hmm. with Dean, and like for once in her life, she doesn't run around on Dean or decide to cheat on somebody.
Yeah.
And anyway. Paris had the hots for Tristan, and she sees Tristan at the school, runs into the bathroom and has a total meltdown. I'm still in love mm-hmm. with Tristan, and Paris is going through a divorce, so she's going through this crisis.
Which, like, wow, there's nothing in my briefcase.
Yeah, she brought a briefcase so she'd look important, but there was actually nothing in it.
And when she slams the door closed
with
her
foot
and just stands there.
That ninja move.
I love
it.
It
was so great.
I understand, like, that kind of breakdown. Just like, no, done, shut it down.
Yeah.
I do hope that she and Doyle work things out.
Yeah,
I
feel like her reasons for leaving Doyle are a little flimsy.
Well, she's done this before when they were in Yale, and didn't she like try to leave him for a different reason that was kind of flimsy? But Doyle's like, nah, I love you.
Yeah.
Gonna be together. Doyle also sounds like a flapper.
Everybody sounds like a 20s flapper.
Everyone. It's me, Richard. We're gonna buy some office supplies together, Lorelai. That's no way to talk on a business call.
So,
anyway.
Moments that you cried were at the very beginning, at the funeral, oh, at the wedding.
The wedding.
The phone call. What other moments did you cry?
Oh, there had to have been
The song, the I'm Not Unbreakable.
I'm Not Unbreakable.
That was pretty amazing.
Oh, when Emily, like, has her new kind of family of just her employees.
Oh, yeah.
And they're all, like, staying with her in Nantucket, yeah. and she goes to warm up soup incorrectly
uh-huh.
for Berta, and Berta's just like, this woman.
She doesn't
her
even
whole
know
life.
How to.
Yeah. Doesn't even know how to use a microwave. But so sweet. I was like, oh, my God, she's caring about people.
Right.
She's taking them into her house.
And the other moment, and Jilly the P actually sent a text about this, when Lorelai, because earlier in the show, Emily commissioned a portrait of Richard and clearly pulled a total spinal tap and had the wrong dimensions because this thing was massive.
Yes.
It fills an entire wall. And Lorelai says, just get what you want. Tell them what you want. And Emily won't fess up to the fact that she made a mistake. Mm-hmm. And then she finally does and makes Lorelai feel bad about pointing out that she knew she made a mistake. But at the end when Emily is you know, she's really grown. This is towards the end of the final episode. Lorelai sees something in the corner. She walks over and she realizes it's the correct size painting of Richard. That was pretty emotional, too.
Yeah, and then she has it with her in Nantucket, and she, like, kisses her
yeah.
hand and kisses Richard goodnight.
Basically anything with Richard. Oh, and when Rory's walking around the house and she opens the door to the office and sees Richard there. Oh, my God.
Lost it.
Yes.
And that's where she goes to write her book, is in Richard's office.
I did love that.
Mm-hmm. That was
pretty
great.
She's following the footsteps of her grandfather.
Yep.
Good for her.
That was awesome.
You know what I have a hard time coming to grips with is how much you love these characters, yet how freely you admit that they are horrible people.
Well, look,
and how does that happen?
Because everybody has wonderful people in their lives, and these people at the same time can be really horrible.
Yeah, everybody is flawed. Like, I'm pretty great, but I'm also awful a lot of the time.
Yeah, right. And show me a person that isn't awful some of the time.
Right?
Or isn't selfish, you know?
Because they're well-written, flawed, messed up, lovable characters.
So funny, too.
They can't all be perfect. Smart. They can't all be Kirk.
And there's a lot more to the show than just Rory.
Yeah.
Right.
There's a lot. I hate Rory. I'm going to say it. And these four episodes just really ingrained that.
She was she was pretty bad.
Oh, God.
Because we talked about this in the first hour, all the Logan stuff. What the heck?
Too much.
Just awful. How it was like, yeah, we're Vegas. And yet she's like, oh, but Odette, she's coming and calling him like every 2 seconds.
Yeah.
But
that's what she does. I mean, when she was at Yale and she goes on that date with that crappy dude that her grandma set her up with, and who does she call? Married Dean.
Yeah.
Who of course goes running off.
Yes.
From his wife.
Which, like, you know, we have to hold Logan every bit as accountable as Rory in this affair.
Oh, yeah.
Rory doesn't for a single minute pretend to give a crap about Odette.
Nope.
Just like, oh, she's there. I have to stay at a hotel like a peasant?
Yeah. Or Pete Paul.
Pete slash Paul. Sometimes Paul, mostly Pete. Poor guy. Although he seems like he's got to have something going on if he's hanging on to this absent woman.
Yeah.
Like after a couple of months of not seeing her, you should be like, you know what? I'm just going to talk to some other ladies.
Yeah.
He's a good looking guy. He can do it.
Jilly the Peace sends a text saying how we feel about whether or not there should be more episodes.
Oh, you said right.
I don't think there should be. I love the way it ended.
I love it. I mean, part of me is so angry that there was such a cliffhanger.
Yeah.
And part of me is like, what? You're not going to develop on that. But another thing is, I don't want to see things develop.
And
I
feel like we know.
Can I just say without giving anything
away? No spoilers.
No spoilers.
No.
We're going to cut you.
They've already done it. That whole thing would be what you would see.
I feel like we know enough about all the characters from all 7 seasons and these 4 that we can write our own storyline, and it's going to be exactly what we want, and there's not going to be any need for any further episodes. I know everything I need to know about all the characters to feel like I know what would happen, and it makes me really happy.
Yeah, to quote Lorelai in her most recent fight with Emily, full friggin' circle.
Full friggin' circle. Totally.
Mm-hmm. That kind of encompasses everything that we can worry about with happening with the story.
Right.
So you'd be down with no more?
Yeah. I don't want any more. Because for me, it all the development, all the changes in the characters, it all worked for me. I don't mind the end at all. I know that a lot of people are bothered by it, but I don't have a problem with it.
I think you have to be happy to have an ending to something you love.
Exactly.
We
finally got an
ending. The 7th season.
And we got the correct ending. We didn't get whatever that mess was that was on the WB.
Yeah. There is an amount of closure because, and I read somewhere that actually Lauren Graham was one of the producers for the final season.
Oh, really?
And she was kind of just working with what she had because the Paladinos weren't involved, so things were a mess.
Yeah.
But it still was not satisfactory. And now the Paladinos were involved. I think they properly closed it up.
I think so, too. I was interested to find out that when they went back to work and they were going over the storylines for this, that Lauren Graham completely forgot about stuff that happened in season 7.
She forgot
that her and Christopher were briefly married. She completely forgot that.
I think a lot of people.
I think that's kind of easily forgettable.
That whole thing just sat really weird with me. I mean, why would she just run off and not tell Rory that she was going to be marrying Christopher?
And her entire marriage to Christopher was like a three episode arc.
Yeah.
At most.
At most.
It ended so quickly.
Yeah. It was ridiculous.
I think she even, like, the episode after they got married, I remember Emily being pissed because she got a voicemail that was saying, like, hey, Mom, Christopher and I, we're just getting back from France. Also, we got married. Bye. Which is how I think the audience felt. We're like, okay.
Right.
I don't care anymore.
Yeah. Man.
Christopher.
We're at the bottom of the hour. I'm going to play Station ID and then another song. And then we got to talk more Gilmore Girls. Half hour left in Gilmore Gab. Send your comments, questions, whatever. Shufflefunction@hotmail.com. Julie the P was waltzing in her cubicle during that Sam Phillips song.
I thought she was not going to work. Julie the P.
She's a responsible
adult. We were
going to
call
adult.
You in with the plague. What did you just point at in your notes?
Lend us some of their gays.
Oh, that's right. They were going to have a pride parade in Stars Hollow, but they didn't have enough gay people. So they called out to other towns around the area to see if they could borrow
lend us some
gays.
My favorite part, I think, of the entire revival. Here it is. Are you ready?
I know what you're going to say.
It's just Gypsy going, are you sure, Taylor? There aren't any other people who are gay. Taylor,
are you sure?
Are you sure about it?
And everybody's looking at Taylor like, this is going to be the moment where he admits that he's gay.
He's just like, no, I don't know what you're talking about.
And Gypsy's like, all right, we cleared that up.
Yeah, that was funny.
That was Barry Manilow with Looks Like We Made It. And before that, Sam Phillips with Reflecting Light. Is that a key song?
Oh, it's the key song. Luke and Lorelai have their first dance to it. And then during the whole thing where they kind of run off and do an elopement before the actual marriage, that's playing in the background. During this whole kind of, the whole thing where they... Luke and Lorelai, the night before the wedding, they're sitting at the table feeling like we should have done this a long time ago. And then they have this realization that in town, it was bingo night and the pastor was up pretty late. Mm-hmm. So they decide, let's just go and elope. And so they get Lorelai or they get Rory and they go to the center of town, and this whole thing is set up by Kirk, and it's really kind of dreamlike and almost musical set quality. And that song is playing in the background, and it's really beautiful.
I love that song.
Oh, yeah. So good.
It's kind of typical for Lorelai, too, because, like, any other person would be like, okay, we're going to be married in 10 hours. Let's go hang out. We'll watch some cartoons for a few hours. Maybe take a nap. It's 10 o'clock at night. Let's go to bed.
Right.
Any normal person would just be like, I can wait. It's been like 20 years. We can wait. Mm-hmm. No, she's like, let's just do this. Let's skip the whole wedding ceremony and let's just do it in a mystical light garden in the center of town. Yep. Because we
not allow any of our friends and family to be there.
Yep.
With
they were,
us.
Yeah. They were still going to do it the next day.
Oh, mm-hmm. Right.
But they
just
to take
like,
the pressure
let's
off.
Just do this.
Okay. Couldn't take another minute. Yeah. Not being
and it was
married.
Beautiful. It was really sweet.
It was.
Yeah.
So did you keep a running count of how much coffee was drank during these revivals?
No, but if you go to these reviews on Birth, Movies, Death, actually foreveryoungadult.com is the website. Meredith, what is her name? I don't remember. Oh, Meredith Borders. For every episode, she says how many cups of coffee. So during the summer one, the Gilmore Girls drink 7 cups.
That's it?
Yeah. Surprisingly,
you guys have
amount.
Drunk more than 7 cups this morning.
I think you're right. Yeah, it feels like it.
I drained a Stanley thermos. This thing is a good liter and a half. And then I had another cup from Shelly. It's delicious, by the way.
Oh.
Yeah, it was good
Folger's
coffee.
Folger's breakfast blend.
You know what? I'm a fancy.
I'm glad that it can finally be used. I bought that whole thing before I stopped drinking coffee.
Oh, my God.
I feel like we maybe should talk about the Life and Death Brigade. Because we've been talking about it off mic, saving all our ranting for off mic.
So mad.
But man, I could not. I already don't like Logan. I've never liked that Life and Death Brigade. So to have them show up at the end of this series and knowing everything that's been going on with Logan and Rory running around on their mates, it just made me angry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they just kind of like whisked her away.
Yeah.
Like stupid rich tooth fairies.
Who could buy the town and make everybody go to bed at a decent hour so that they could be creepy and weird on the streets of Stars Hollow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that what they did?
Yeah. Rory's walking down the street and there's nobody around and it's foggy and like this street sign changes to like a message for her and there's a bird up in the tree saying, Rory, are you ready? Or whatever. And then these guys show up out of nowhere and take her off on this adventure on a really set to a really terrible Beatles cover. Don't even get me started on that terrible cover. God,
I think they sang it, didn't they?
Oh, it was, oh, God.
Get by with a little help from my
friends.
Yeah,
with a little help from my friends. Terrible, gross. Terrible cover.
They were just ripping off Across the Universe at best.
Yeah,
aside
yeah
from, like,
that's true.
Did they just do it for fun?
Yep.
Just like, Rory, you need a break.
Like everything that these guys do, they did it because they could.
Because Rory needs a break from being unemployed and traveling the world and having a generally easy time.
Yeah.
I'm trying to stifle
I'm going to go Hulk in a second. Let's just take a moment here for you to make the most rageous sound towards Rory as you can, just to get it out. Ready? I'll give you a countdown from five.
I'm going to skitter away from the mic.
Wait, let me get the mics down here a little bit. Okay.
There we go.
Okay.
Are you ready? So go 5, 4, 3.
Come on! What?
Oh my
Why?
God. What's wrong with you?
Are you kidding me?
Oh my God! How can you mess up so much?
Oh, that felt good. I think we all
Is
needed
that. Cathartic?
That. I love that you hate Rory so much. Like, these four episodes must have been killing you.
They were.
These guys just want to talk about her. Her experiences with men? How can I say that in a nice way?
Her horrible life choices?
Yeah. And I said, you better not, because Tim thinks she's a good girl.
Well, I think I think everybody is a decent person that makes bad decisions.
But
and
she
she's made a lot.
Over and
she's
over
made a
and
lot
over.
Of bad decisions, mm-hmm. and it was like an exclamation point in these four episodes.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
And again,
was, I think, the thing about Rory that drove me craziest in these four episodes is that she made this. Here she is, and she's doing it again.
And I can't stress enough how I don't want Rory to get slut shamed. Like, you could do whatever
you
want.
Oh my God.
Live
your life, exactly.
But she's constantly doing things that hurt other people. It sucks.
It's not about slut shaming. It's about choice shaming.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's that her bad decisions mm-hmm. impact the lives of others.
It's like she constantly comes to different crossroads throughout the revival, and we're like, you can go this way and make a choice that might be difficult, but it's going to be harrowing, and you're going to grow as a person. Or you can go down this road where you just ruin the lives of a bunch of other people.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go.
Let's
do
that.
That sounds good. I'm Rory.
I know.
The worst.
But yet you love her.
Well, yeah.
Do
Except
I?
Except Mindy.
I do. I do.
Well, did Lorelai teach her that?
Lorelai definitely, I think, kind of raised her, yes, to kind of get away with that. Because what I saw in the seven original seasons, Lorelai so much didn't want to be like her parents.
Right.
And mm-hmm. then raised Rory to be just like
just
her
like
parents.
Her. Oh, sure.
Yeah.
So Rory never had to work. Mm-hmm. Like, never had. She just went to Chilton and, like, Yale and didn't have to pay for any of that.
Yeah.
And, you know, went off and lived with her grandparents. Just had the privileged life that Lorelai fought so hard
right.
to mm-hmm. be away from.
Yeah.
And it didn't appreciate it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think
exactly.
that's probably true.
Well, I gotta leave, and I'm
you
so
have to go
sad.
To the dentist.
You enjoy
That's
that Pop-Tart
horrible.
Later on. Though.
I'm gonna console myself with this Pop-Tart after I get stabbed in the gums.
Take
a few
the mug
times.
With you.
I'm taking the mug. I'm gonna drink it
this is
on my
too,
way
Mindy.
Out.
Oh yeah,
it's a Mindy mug. But thank you for having
oh,
me.
Oh, thank you, Kaylin,
and letting me rage scream.
yeah, that was the
muted
best
microphone.
Very, very good.
It was very cathartic.
I'm gonna play.
I hope everybody did it out there.
I'm gonna play some Big Star right now with 13, and we'll be back with more Gilmore Gab in just a moment. Won't you let me? Ash with Girl from Mars on 89.7 The Maverick,
and Big Star with 13. All the songs you've heard today were at some point on the Gilmore Girls show.
There's so many good songs in that show.
Mm-hmm.
Say what you want about it, Amy Sherman-Palladino has really good taste in music.
Or somebody doing the show.
No, I think it's her.
You think so?
I think everything, every aspect of that show came from her fevered brain.
Her fevered brain.
I just marvel at that show and the writing and how fast it is. And I just wonder, how does she write like that?
Mm-hmm. Maybe it's she so talks dense. Like that.
She probably does. And every interview I've seen with her seems to indicate that she does talk like that.
I know at the reunion or...
At that festival.
Yeah. She said they had to talk fast just because she had so much that she wanted to put in each episode. Uh-huh. That was the only way that they could condense it enough. Yeah.
And the scripts are famous for being twice as long as a normal script because there's just so much dialogue. And if you look at the new episodes, right after the credits, it says information for like the German version and the Spanish version. And I wonder what it must be like to dub this dialogue. There's an extra on I think the season one or season two DVDs where it talks about dubbing it into other languages and how some things just don't translate with all these pop culture references and everything.
Oh, sure.
But man, I can't even imagine. You got to be able to breathe. Even they even kind of comment on that in the very first scene. Mm-hmm. Rory starts talking really fast and she's like, "Whew,
haven't done that in a while."
Yeah, exactly. So that was a pretty good funny moment. This is your last couple minutes here, Mindy. If you have anything you need to get off your chest before the end of this show, now is the time to do it.
Now, as somebody that doesn't like Rory, you still were happy with the show?
I was. Not going to lie, not as in love with it as Caitlin. It did get better.
Uh-huh.
Like the last, that fall episode was like, oh, yes.
Yeah.
But it took a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
It was a little slow there. Why was Rory in London to begin with?
Probably just for Logan?
Well, was she working on that book thing at the time?
That didn't start, though, until, like, after it started.
Then it would have been just to hook up with Logan.
But nobody knew she... Like, wouldn't someone have thought of that? Like, people knew he was in London.
You mean, like, the people in her world?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think she was really open with anybody. I mean, even Lorelai didn't know that she was still even in really contact with him when they were having the speech during the Wookiee scene.
But I would have thought, oh, you're just going to London? Hey, Logan lives in London.
Yeah. Well, she had that cover story about her friend Dee Dee.
She did.
Yeah.
I went and bought it.
Well, it would have been a much shorter series then, I think, because you would have seen through all of Rory's lies. Jeez.
I know why she's there, but I can't say because of the end of the show.
Yeah.
That's probably what was going on.
Yeah. Yeah. Are you team Jess or Logan or Dean?
I'm team Jess.
I'm totally team Jess. I wasn't at the time, and when he was happening, he was just such an infuriating, maddening character. But man, he turned into like the most together person on that show, practically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That one episode when... He opened that bookstore or whatever it was, and she went back.
And he totally called her on her crap.
Yeah.
That was amazing. Yeah, that was the moment I realized Jess is the one that she should have been with the whole time.
Wow, we're at the end of the show
I know,
already.
We're at the end of the show. I got to play one more song. And that's going to be it for Gilmore Gab. But
la, la, la.
Sing it with us, Billy.
La, 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 la. La, 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 la. Gilmore Gab.
My favorite band, Yula Tango, with My Little Corner of the World, bringing Gilmore Girls,
Gilmore Gab,
to an end.
I'm so glad you could make it here, Mindy.
Thanks to Caitlin, who's now at the dentist.
Yeah.
For Gilmore Gab. Thanks to Jilly the P, who weighed in.
Yes.
To the text machine.
Thanks to Michael number 3 for the Pop-Tarts.
Thanks to Amy Sherman-Palladino.
Oh, so much thanks.
So are you still like the love of your life as Lorelai?
Oh, forever. She is forever my love. Forever my love.
He's not joking.
No, oh, I it's
know.
True.
I know. I didn't know if it would be okay if I brought up that her real life boyfriend was in the show.
You know, I've come to terms with it.
Okay. Well, Lauren Graham is not Lorelai.
That's true.
This is the Maverick. KMSU 89.7 FM Mankato.
Look
KMSK 91.3 FM Austin. Operating and translator K220AQ in Fairmont. K220AR in Albert Lee. We're also available online at KMSU.org. And we're a proud member of Independent Public Radio.
La, la, la.